So, dark patterns. What is this? Probably everyone who has used the internet recently has seen this obnoxious banner, you need to use cookies to use the site. And then you are presented with an easy answer in green and shiny, yes to all. Or you can reject them and have to click 400 individual check boxes. This is a dark pattern. And Dark Unicorn will now present us with the details about it from a developer's perspective and what you can do about it and how do we want to discuss this. So welcome and a round of applause in front of your screen. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Exactly. I'm going to shake my screen accidentally. I want to talk a bit about the parts of dark patterns that make them so obnoxious and why they work. And also as a developer who, as a web developer, I want to talk a bit about the business side of things. And so yeah, let's just get started. What are dark patterns? Well, dark patterns are tricks used in websites and apps that make you do things that you didn't mean to, like buying or signing up for something, which is the definition from darkpatterns.org, which is a very good site on the topic. What does that mean? I'm defining them as design choices that are intentionally inaccessible to further the cause of capitalist profit maximization, which definitely is a bit politically charged, but that's intentional. So a bit more specific, XKCD has also made this perfect example for a very annoying dark pattern that is like the most common form that you encounter basically every day. So yes, cookie consent forms, or I wouldn't actually call them consent because that's not what consent means. So why are dark patterns? Well, first of all, obviously capitalism, profit maximization being valued over a good user experience, seeing the customers as simple numbers, not people. And sadly, another part of it is that journalism is dying because they can't finance themselves if no one buys the newspaper subscriptions anymore. So they need to finance themselves and they fall back to dark patterns, sadly. Everybody's doing it. It's also kind of a reason because there are these pre-built libraries that you can just include to be GDPR safe that include dark patterns. So it's rather easy to add a dark pattern to your site by accident or by incompetence, whatever. So, and there's also the botched privacy regulations like the GDPR, which in general was a very good idea. Like giving people more control over their own data, limiting how the data can be abused by companies. However, it wasn't written in a good way, especially around cookies. So yeah, these consent forms that are legal and in the end only hurt the customer because your data is still being stolen. However, you just have to click away some annoying pop-up every time you use the internet. So, let's dissect some examples as to how dark patterns work and what they're doing. The first thing that you can see a lot is reject option styling and position. So accept is always the primary color that usually you want to click every time you just want to finish a task. The reject button is either grayed out, so it doesn't look like you can click it at all. Which is also really bad if the contrast is too low to actually read what the button is saying, or they don't look like a button at all. We have this wonderful example from the Windows 10 installation. The red border was added to show actually where one has to click if they want to install the OS without creating a Microsoft account. So that usually is just this limited experience text that is where you would usually have to click if you wanted to go back a step because you want to delete some setting you already made. So that's definitely one way where you simply, if you're not an expert in parsing these things. You simply don't know how to not consent. Another thing is interesting use of language. So obviously difficult to understand language for non-technical folks. Switching language between ciphertext and consent form, which is common, that the cite is in German, for example, and then the consent form is in English. Or as this wonderful example here is, the form switches languages in between saying what it is about and what the actual cookies are used for, which definitely would be an issue if I didn't speak both languages. So there's also the double negative, do not send me no marketing emails. So you just have to think a bit what you're actually saying if you hit that checkbox. And also learn more. That doesn't equal no. And on most sites where you have to hit learn more to say no, which doesn't actually make that much sense. Another thing is blocking the user from quickly closing the pop-up. Some sites go as far as ruining the scrolling to make it impossible to close in-app browsers. Like in many in-app browsers, you have to scroll up to make it to make the little X button visible to close the in-app browser, and they ruin your scrolling so you can't close it, which is especially annoying if you've accidentally clicked some link in Twitter or whatever, and then you can't go out of these websites without without closing the whole app. The close buttons also doesn't mean I consent, but sites simply say it does. So if it's a modal and you just hit the close X on the corner, or if you just hit the backdrop, which will close the modal in many sites, they will say that means I consent, but it does not mean that. There's also the way too many checkboxes. Here I've got an example where there's a bunch of text. Then there's a small little frame that scrolls individually where all the checkboxes are. So you always have to scroll to see every single change, every single thing you might want to change, which is definitely annoying. And there's the wonderful disregard my choices button underneath the checkboxes. So you just went through all of these 400 checkboxes, said no to every single one, and then you hit accept all, and suddenly your choices aren't worth anything. Then there's also one thing, because this isn't just about cookie consent, it's about trying to sell your subscriptions when you don't want them. Many sites will default to some kind of subscription when you buy something, like we've got these subscribe and save things from Amazon, where the button that usually would buy just one means that you will get like every 2 months a new delivery without it looking any different than buying a single product. And if you're tired or not very adept at the language, or simply just got this pop-up fatigue because you just constantly have to click the lighting up button to just do what you were trying to do, this is definitely very likely to trick you. There's also this Humble Bundle example here, where this add to cart button seems like it would add the bundle to your cart, because it says total one item, €0. So it looks like you don't actually have the bundle in your cart at that point, which you don't, because you haven't selected an amount. But if you hit add to cart, you will add this €16 subscription, which doesn't really have anything to do with the bundle you are trying to buy. Then there's also a forced action. With things like impossible to close pop-ups, like login to continue, which is especially annoying if the site lets you see some parts of it, like Instagram does. So you were shown someone linked to their Instagram, you were scrolling down and suddenly you have to log into Instagram or install the app to continue seeing what you were trying to see. There's also many news sites do this. A button, if you want to read the article, you have to disable your ad block. Otherwise, you're just going to see this annoying page. I don't actually know how they're doing it to disable the ad block, but probably there's some API. And another thing I found interesting is that sites tell you you cannot not consent to cookies if your browser setting doesn't say do not track. They also tell you how to set that setting. However, that's a lot of steps, and also many sites simply disregard that setting or refuse to work with it set. So when the do not track setting was first added, I remember enabling it and suddenly being left with an unusable internet. So yeah, that's also a dark pattern because people have to go out of their way to not be tracked. Another like smaller thing is this login with Google Everywhere. It pops up on every subpage on sites that include it. And I don't really see any benefit in logging in with Google to read some blog post because I just want to read some text. It's nothing I have to write a comment or anything. And every time I open a new subpage, this pop-up will annoy me. So I might just click at this button once, and then it's gone for as long as the session cookie lasts. Then there's the building up pressure, which is especially common on hotel booking sites. So you have time-sensitive deals that commonly aren't time-sensitive at all, but they look like it. Like you see here, 19% today off. Tomorrow it will also be 19% off, but it's today. There will also be the almost sold out. Here we have three different kinds of rooms in some hotel, and they only have 5 left for every single one. I guess they only had 5 to begin with, but now it looks like in red text, it looks like that's a small amount, so you just got to book now to not miss out on it. And there's also the X people are looking at this right now. I was actually trying to find it on a hotel booking site, but apparently even they know that in 2021, no one would believe it, that some hotel booking site is heavily trafficked and you have to buy now. But here's the a bit less bad example from eBay, where it says this was opened 17 times, 86 were already sold, and we only have 8 left. So buy now or you're not going to get it at all. And a whole collection of dark patterns is what you will find if you try to cancel your Prime membership. I actually thought I had canceled my Prime membership a couple of months ago before checking for this talk. So in order to cancel your Prime membership, you have to go to this My Prime. Then you go to Advanced Controls, go to My Prime Membership. Then you have to open this little carrot thing, which allows you to end your membership. Then you will get a very scary alert message. Attention, by canceling, you will lose the following benefits. Then there will be a button, not let me cancel, but it is I do not want my benefits, or I want to keep my benefits. But we're not done even if we hit the I do not want my benefits button, because then you will be sent to another site which says, well, good news. Exclusively for you, Prime for less money. That is not an exclusive deal. It's simply if you decide to pay once a year, and that's available for everyone at all times. So that's actually kind of a lie. So let's say, okay, that deal didn't get me to keep my membership. So I will hit end membership. Then I will be sent to yet another subsite where I finally get to end my membership and Prime benefits like at the next possible time. And then once you click that, you will be redirected to a site which will show multiple scary alerts, like you've just made some mistake, which you can obviously undo with a single click because they make subscribing as easy as they can. You will also get multiple emails. And when you buy something for the next time, it will give you some actual deal, I think. I don't know if you can get Prime for a euro for a week. And some red text alert telling you, yeah, you really want to resubscribe to Prime for some reason. And they keep changing my language, which is kind of annoying, but not the point here. However, one thing that's good about Amazon, it was possible to unsubscribe online. So this is the New York Times. Theoretically, you could chat with a customer care advocate to unsubscribe. However, all of them are currently occupied, so you could call this US phone number, which definitely is not possible for everyone and is a huge additional step just to cancel some subscription that you definitely did not use a phone call to start. And when looking at these things, it's also important to note that these things are a lot worse if you're disabled. So phone calls may not be possible for anxiety reason or if you're deaf or a whole lot of different reasons. Low contrast, like in these disagree buttons, may not be visible. And in general, there's a lot more physical motion necessary to accomplish your goals. And it's likely that they will also not have the appropriate tab index setting set for those checkboxes where you can theoretically disagree. In addition to being worse if you're disabled, they are also a lot worse if you don't have much money. Because not consenting is a very time-consuming thing to do. And if you're just on your break and just want to catch up on some news, that's possible. That's not possible in many cases. Cheap monitors also handle low contrast really badly. So even if you're not colorblind, you might not be able to see the contrast because your screen is just too cheap. When you hit more options or learn more or whatever, sites often reload, which uses more bandwidth and more time spent rendering, especially on low-powered hardware. And also, failing to cancel a subscription can hurt a lot financially. Like I just said, I didn't realize that I hadn't canceled my Prime subscription. That is a sign of real financial privilege that I have in this case. So if I didn't have that, it would be a huge problem to just spend €8 a month for something I didn't want. And I've got something to admit, because I have actually implemented a dark pattern before. It was at my first real job after I've got my apprenticeship. And it was at a company where I had actually thought they would never do such a thing because they were really popular and kind of like caring about their customers, at least what they show to the outside. I also tried to talk management out of it, but that wasn't possible at the time. So about 6 months later, I left the company. I was pretty burnt out, and like leaving your first job this early also makes one doubt their skills a lot, because like especially if you've already got low self-esteem, that's really difficult. And I also definitely felt like shit for ignoring my moral standards, because I do not want dark patterns on the internet, and I had just implemented one. However, I'm happy it turned out that way. I'm no longer at the company. I'm at a different one where I'm a lot happier. But well, that's my personal story. But what does it say about your job if you have to implement a dark pattern? It says that your employer sees maximizing profits as more important than respecting their users, because shoving a dark pattern down their throat is definitely no sign of respect. So they probably think of their customers in terms of how much money they can make from them. So they're likely to think of their employees similarly, which often leads to things like not enough appreciation for your work, too many tasks in too little time, or no ways to use work time for non-directly money-making activities such as education, which definitely would profit them if they allowed you to educate yourself on time. However, it only profits them after a bit of time. So they want to make as much money as quickly as possible, so they will not allow you to do that in many cases, definitely not always. And you simply do not have to accept this. Well, what can you do against it? First step, obviously, talk with your employer. Maybe they can be reasoned with. Maybe they didn't know how bad it was to implement something like that. So that's definitely a good idea. If that doesn't lead to anything, you could join a labor union, which gets you a better bargaining position with your employer, and try to talk with them again. Found a workers' council, which allows you to speak for everyone who voted for you, which means employers often tend to isolate your issues. Like, you're the only one who doesn't want the stock pattern, so it's a personal issue that you have. If you're a part of a workers' council, you can say, no, it isn't. These people all voted for me. It's my job to talk to you about it, and yeah, I can speak for them. And if none of that is possible or doesn't work, you can quit your job, because tech professionals are always in high demand, even during a pandemic where it's a bit more difficult to find a job, but it is still possible. And you may even get like-minded colleagues to leave with you and maybe found a corporation where you would end up with a lot better working environment. Well, thank you all for listening. Slides will be published on my blog. I'm also reachable on that email address if you couldn't find, if you weren't able to ask in the following Q&A, which we have a bunch of time left for. So yes, have a nice remaining conference, everyone. And thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you. So we are going to go through the questions. The first one is, could you give some details about what dark patterns they wanted from you? Like, I guess, what you were asked to implement at your first job, if you want to answer that.
Well, I can't exactly say it because, like, NDA stuff, but it was about making customers use spend more money because they were, like, nudged to go with a different plan.
Next question. Well, it's more of a remark. As you spoke about Amazon Prime, that Sky is probably also difficult to cancel your subscription. And we obviously don't have that many questions this time. I see something top typed in right now. So all everyone who is still in the IRC chat or looking at the pad or at the stream, you find that in the video description, there's a link to this question and answering pad. And I see people are using it right now, so they are coming in. And yeah, so let's just wait for a minute for more questions to come in. And do you have any more remarks that you want to fill the time with, maybe?
I just chose chose Amazon Prime because I wanted some really bad example, and I just knew it was one of the worst experiences to cancel Prime because I remember doing it before, and I apparently failed at doing so. So yeah, obviously lots of pages are similar. It's not like Amazon is the only bad player here. Yeah.
And obviously there's a monetary incentive for companies to nudge people in this direction. And also if the network effects or the everyone is doing that, so we should do that too, is obviously a concern. So if you are in a position to discuss or even change that, you can make for a better internet for everyone, basically, because you you inhibit a precedent, like a bad example, and you can change that indirectly so that others don't see it as a bad example that they have to copy. So there's a lot of questions coming in. Oh, I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
Yes, that's also really true, because as the more websites use dark patterns, the less bad it feels for people to implement them, because always, yeah, everyone's doing it, why wouldn't I? So yeah, definitely, if you can block a dark pattern, definitely do so.
Right. Oh yeah, now people are waking up and posting questions. So let's see if we get short answers to short questions. So you already said you had concerns in your first job. did management come up with excuses or justifications, or did they just like, we pay you to do this, so do it, please?
I don't think there was a place in there. I wasn't able to speak directly with the people making the decisions. I was talking with my team lead, and he said he didn't think it was a bad thing, but he said, okay, if you're concerned about this, I talk to management, and then I never heard anything about it again. So it wasn't really possible to speak with anyone who would actually listen and understand why it's an issue.
Yeah, so that proves that it's really difficult to get into that in that position to be able to make a choice. So there's a question regarding the eBay example. What in your eyes are the difference between a dark pattern and information, and how to identify them?
Yeah, the eBay example actually is a bit of a gray area for me, because if something is going to be sold out soon, I kind of want to know it, because it would be bad not to, it would be really bad not to get what I want. But in many cases, these X people are looking at this right now aren't even real. So there are many sites where you can just refresh and it will show you a different random number every time. That's definitely a dark pattern. With the eBay example, it was just something I could find quickly because I wanted to use stuff that I could screenshot. And as I said, the hotel booking sites currently don't employ this because they know you wouldn't believe it.
So I guess this goes into the direction of cognitive biases and logical fallacies and like simulating scarcity, like just 5 hotel rooms, for example, left. So hurry up, even if no, if you can't verify that there's just 5.
Yes.
Next question: there are also dark patterns for increasing engagement with a site or retention times. So people look at the site for longer times, including videos that autoplay or follow you as you scroll down. We all know that from social media of some sorts. Do you have any experience with those or a comment on that?
Yeah, so the thing is, these videos, I don't know anyone who actually enjoys those. I think everyone is annoyed by them, but that may be just my bubble. The retention, keeping retention is definitely a large issue, especially with commercialized social networks like Twitter that will not show your notifications, for example, when they come in, if lots of notifications come in at once, so they can spread them out over time. So you get another reason to look at the app, or the algorithm is like built to always seem like there's new content for you. So you're always kind of missing out, and you get that fear of missing out on something like your best friend wrote or anything. Those are definitely very harmful. There's luckily some social media that isn't built like that. So you can still get the experience of screaming into the void and pretending you're socializing. So that's good, but yeah, those are definitely very harmful. And I know I'm easily victimized by it because I do spend too much time on social media.
And I bet there's a lot of people who are very good at evoking exactly these feelings and these reactions. So you mentioned that many libraries implement the GDPR cookie setting in a bad way. Are there any libraries that offer a nice cookie banner?
I can't name any right now because I haven't actually on my own terms implemented anything that actually requires a cookie banner, because everything that requires a cookie banner is something that most people wouldn't actually consent to, like tracking people. And there's even tracking libraries that don't require consent because they only track stuff that happens on your site and don't like try to steal all data they can. So there's definitely better options. I've seen some same looking ones that had okay positioned buttons and a reject all button that was just there, but I can't tell you any names right now.
Then I will add that some listener pointed out that there's non-NGOs non-governmental organizations like EDRI, European Digitalized, or Digital Courage, and so on, and linked a note on ethical web development. So that's valuable, I think. And people were appreciating your focus on low, and especially low income situations, and that how exploitative this is. Then here is a question about if you know something about LinkedIn.
I do know that it is pretty terrible from my experience. Like LinkedIn employs a bunch of dark patterns. The cookie stuff is definitely there, if I remember correctly. They will always tell you that you should install their app because the experience is so much better. No, actually, when you install the app, they get more data. And they send you so many emails, even if nothing actually happened. So they will send you like a daily email about you were found on X searches. Look at LinkedIn right now, even though no one actually interacted with you. That's even the reason why I had to ignore some interesting recruiters while searching for a job earlier this year, because it was just a flood of useless information with just tiny bits of useful stuff in between. I actually created a whole other LinkedIn inbox and it's got 120 unread emails, even though I always try to see all of my emails. So yeah, LinkedIn is a perfect example for a site that employs dark patterns, in my opinion.
I experienced similar things also, for example, with eBay, that they also flood you with a lot of information that you have never asked for. So do you have suggestions how to do something about it on as a user? How can you sort through this, even if you can't actively change the thing or the way things are, so that you don't have to quit using the service or the site or whatever, but improving your experience yourself?
So there for many popular websites, there are third-party clients that will employ less dark patterns. So if you want to look at someone's Twitter profile, there's knitter.at, if I remember correctly. So it's a client that simply just shows you the timeline of what someone posted. There's also YouTube frontends that don't apply as many dark patterns and don't shove some autoplay suggestion down you as soon as you stop watching something. But in the end, if we are forced to use those sites and if they keep using dark patterns, we are kind of in a bad position because we can't do so much about it. Especially if sites don't have these improved third-party frontends that obviously they don't like, so they will commonly change their APIs, so those frontends will no longer work, or they ban them in their terms of use. So I don't really know what we can do except complain and complain loudly and maybe talk with our lawmakers so they could take steps to make this whole situation a lot better for us.
That's kind of sad news, but I guess we have to keep trying and trying to make a difference, or we also need to reboot the internet.
Yes.
But I don't know if this will happen anytime soon. We are done with the questions so far. I want to thank you for your presentation and your answers. And so I wish everyone a nice DVOC and a nice Easter.